All right, you guys, well, welcome to tonight's webinar. This is Dr. Taylor Crick joining you for our very first webinar. So I'm really excited to bring you this information tonight. You know, talking about autoimmune diseases, this really is a 21st century health epidemic. And I don't think that a lot of people realize that they're part of it. So I'm really excited to bring this information to everybody. You know, some of you might not really know what autoimmune disease is. You know, when they polled Americans, 90% could not name a single autoimmune condition. So this is really information that needs to get out there. But at the same time, you know, you might not personally have been diagnosed or be suffering with any of these symptoms, and you might not think that this information applies to you. But what I can guarantee you tonight, what I can promise you tonight, is that the five action steps that we're gonna give at the end, the five action steps, they're not just action steps for somebody that's been diagnosed with an autoimmune condition. They're not just action steps for somebody who's expressing an autoimmune symptom or any other health symptom. They're really action steps for every single person. They're action steps that I personally take, that, you know, my wife, that we do for our kids, even though they don't have any of these conditions. Our number one goal is to make sure that they never wind up with them also. So I'm gonna bring up the slides here and kind of go back and forth between my face and the slides, and just, you know, give you some information there. But at the same time, I don't want to just be reading off a piece of paper, and I don't want you to be either. So a lot of it will be, you'll have to look at my face and watch me talk here. But one of the reasons why I am so passionate about this topic is, you know, when we first opened up our clinic, you know, a little over 3 years ago, you know, we see a lot of patients. So you see patients come in, and, you know, we're a chiropractic clinic, so maybe somebody comes in for a musculoskeletal complaint. We don't treat, you know, that many musculoskeletal complaints, but it's still what brings people in. And then you do a health history and they fill out, you know, some intake paperwork, and you see what people are dealing with. And when you see these autoimmune conditions, these 21st century inflammatory conditions, you start to really see, like, wow, first off, this is a huge problem. But then you hear the same story over and over and over again. And it's, you know, I went from this doctor to this doctor. They thought it was this, then they thought it was this. They tested for this, it came back negative. They tested for this. I've been from specialist to specialist. I've been passed through the medical system. I've tried medicine after medicine, and nothing has worked. And so I'm coming to you just, you know, maybe you can help with my back pain, not worry about my autoimmune condition. But that really discouraged me. It's like, this is, you know, first off, a huge growing problem, but then people are getting horrible, horrible answers or lack thereof. And so really the last few years, I've been diving into what really causes an autoimmune condition. So we're going to talk about that. We're going to talk about what is an autoimmune condition? What does that mean? What causes it? What gets you to that point, you know, where you're diagnosed with an autoimmune condition? But then, like I said, the most important thing we're going to talk about tonight are going to be five huge action steps, what you can do to prevent and reverse any autoimmune condition that you might be experiencing. So I'm going to bring up this slideshow here and flip to the next slide here. And I hope that it's working. I know this is perfect. Okay, so this is a 21st century epidemic, and it really, really is growing in astronomical proportions. So officially, it's 25 million Americans. Okay, so huge numbers that this is diagnosed in. Unofficially, 50 to 100 million Americans. Okay, so 50 million is the unofficial number, even through a lot of medical statistics. 100, I've seen this estimated, 100 million Americans, autoimmune conditions. It's the third most prevalent disease category behind cancer and heart disease. It's one of the fastest rising. Approximately one in four Americans has some kind of immune system disorder. Okay, one in six Americans will be diagnosed as autoimmune, one in four women. So one in four of our women will be diagnosed with autoimmune. And that's crazy because, you know, you hear so much, we always talk about women, you hear so much with breast cancer and things like that. The numbers with breast cancer, it's one in 31 one in 31, and this is one in four, are going to be diagnosed with an autoimmune condition. So it definitely attacks women more than men. And then over 90% of the population suffers from chronic inflammation. And I put that in there because, you know, some of these numbers are a little bit gray. 50 to 100 million Americans, or 25 million, maybe it's one in four, maybe it's one in six. You know, researchers have found 80 to 100 different autoimmune conditions and 40 more that might have an autoimmune basis. So when you look at what is really considered, you know, an autoimmune condition, there's a big gray area there. So some things aren't considered autoimmune, some things are. Autism is one that's like, you know, 5 years ago, if you would have said autism is an autoimmune condition, people would have disagreed with you. Fibromyalgia is another big one that, is it autoimmune? No, I would say, most people would say, but does it present very, very similar symptoms, similar causes? Absolutely. So these are inflammatory conditions, and that is over 90% of our population today suffering from inflammatory conditions and chronic inflammation. And now we're not talking about a swollen elbow, a swollen shoulder, a swollen sprained ankle. We are talking about inflammation at the cellular level. Okay, so that can be in your brain cells, that can be in your joint cells, that can be in your gut cells. We're going to talk about those a lot. But inflammation at the cellular level and in your cellular membranes that really affects a little bit of everything. So it's a 21st century epidemic. Here's the numbers. You know, autoimmune thyroid is 6 to 13 million. Once again, a really, really gray area because they don't know for sure. You know, people are diagnosed with a thyroid condition. Is it autoimmune? Hashimoto's is a great example. Hypothyroid, huge, huge problem today. And in fact, that's what our next webinar is going to be on next month in September, is on thyroid conditions. But Hashimoto's is hypothyroidism, and it's estimated that 80% of hypothyroidism in our country is actually Hashimoto's, where the immune system actually begins to attack the cell. So that's hypothyroid. Your thyroid's not functioning as well as it should. The opposite of that is called Graves' disease, and that's where your autoimmune hyperthyroid. Your immune system is actually beginning to attack the thyroid tissue, and that creates a hyperthyroid state. Another one, just ubiquitous in our society, is skin conditions. Psoriasis, 7.5 million. You know, that could fall in with eczema, that could fall in with dermatitis, you know, other skin issues. But 7.5 million from psoriasis alone. Lupus, 3.5 million. Rheumatoid arthritis, 1.3 million. Celiac disease, 3 million. Now, one thing to mention there is celiac disease, that's diagnosed celiac disease, but there's also non-celiac gluten sensitivity, and it's estimated to be about six times this much. So close to 20 million have celiac sensitivity. Crohn's disease, ulcerative colitis, multiple sclerosis, the numbers are really staggering here. And when you look at this chart, it shows you with these different diseases, you know, diabetes is one of the only ones that's actually higher in males than it is in females, type 1 diabetes. And when you look at these conditions, you look at this list that I gave with these numbers, you look at this, and I told you there's 80 to 100 known named autoimmune conditions. So what exactly does that mean? Okay, so I'm going to explain now what it means to be autoimmune. But before I do that, I want to talk about a couple analogies. Okay, I'm going to use a couple analogies. I'm a big fan of analogies and visualization. So I want to explain a couple of those right now so that you can follow with me for the rest of the talk. The first one is a fire. Okay, and that's an analogy for inflammation. And that's a great analogy for inflammation because, you know, if you look at the word, the root of the word is flame. That's exactly what it means. Something is inflamed. It is on fire. Okay, but fire is a spectrum. Okay, and think about this. You know, fire is fire, you might say, but you can have a match, you can have a campfire, you can have a burning building, you can have a forest fire, right? And each one is going to do more destruction, more damage, going to be harder to put out, but it's a spectrum. It's still the same thing. So a match, we're going to talk about that as very little inflammation. A forest fire, we're going to talk about as a lot of inflammation. Really hard to put out, causing a lot of destruction and a lot more severe than a match or even, you know, a campfire. So that's the first one, the fire. So you can either, you know, you can pour gas on a fire or you can pour water on a fire. And we're going to talk about each of those. But I want you to think about that, the fire, because we've all seen that. We all know exactly what I'm talking about. The other analogy is the analogy of an army. Okay. And so we've used this analogy in the past that your immune system is a lot like an army. It's a defense system. It literally is. It's your body's defense system. So just like in our country, you know, we have a defense system and it has, you know, an army, a navy, a marines, it has infantry, it has airborne, it has generals, lieutenants, it has all these components. And that's very, very similar to your immune system. Your immune system is your body's defenses, but it's very, very complex. And so what I want you to do is think about this. We all understand the army, we all understand the defense system to some degree, but to make it a little bit more simple, what I want you to think about is a kind of an ancient defense system. And you'll see why as we move forward, we're going to talk about a couple things. But think back maybe like biblical times. Okay, so there was enough civilization that they had an army. They did fight, they had different ranks, they had, you know, there's a lot of structure, a lot that goes into it. It was not just, you know, two people duking it out. But at the same time, there weren't spies, there weren't missiles, you know, that loses the analogy because our immune system, it has a lot of really cool weapons, but it doesn't have cyber warfare, it doesn't have missiles, it doesn't have nukes, it doesn't have things like that. So if you think about the old army, that analogy is going to work better. So looking into, you know, what is an autoimmune disease? An autoimmune disease is, quite frankly, auto, it comes from the Greek word self, and it's when your immune system begins to attack itself. So imagine that army turns on civilians, you know, starts firing at civilians, maybe out of confusion, maybe out of, you know, they thought it was a bad guy, but it was really a good guy. But, you know, long story short, army did what they weren't supposed to do. And instead of attacking the bad guys, the invaders, they actually started attacking yourself. So that is what an autoimmune condition is. And that's a very, very, you know, simple explanation. But honestly, that's really all that you need. So if the immune system is attacking the thyroid, it creates symptoms. Hypo or hyperthyroid. That can be measured on the lab. You're either going to have too much or too little, what's called TSH, thyroid stimulating hormone. And so what the medical system is going to do is they're going to treat your thyroid, right? Or if it's attacking your digestive system, we might call it Crohn's. We might call it ulcerative colitis. If it's attacking your skin, we might call it psoriasis. We might call it eczema. But the medical system is always going to look at what symptoms are you presenting? What organ is malfunctioning? And they're going to treat that organ with medications and surgery, really. But the reality is that an autoimmune condition, it's not a thyroid condition. It's not a digestive condition. It's not a, you know, nervous system condition when it's multiple sclerosis. It is an immune system issue. So you have to look at what is causing my immune system to go haywire? What's causing my army to backfire and start shooting civilians? You know, that is what we do not want in our bodies or in our news. We don't want our army to start shooting civilians. So you have to look at that. And so many people, they've gone to the doctor, they've had their thyroid checked, or they've been told they have autoimmune this or autoimmune that. They're told, take this medication. They're never told anything about what causes it, what they can do to solve it. And there's a lot of natural solutions. So going back to the slideshow, show you guys here. So there's the women and men, but here's a picture of it. Okay. So this is a picture of, you know, which tissues it could attack. Okay. So when it attacks the thyroid, we call it Hashimoto's, we call it Graves. When it attacks the brain, we call it MS. We call it autism. When it attacks the bones or the joints, we call it RA, rheumatoid arthritis. When it attacks the muscles, maybe fibro, maybe muscular dystrophy. skin, eczema, psoriasis, vitiligo. Vitiligo is a, that's Michael Jackson's disease. Okay, so it's a depigmentation of the skin. So it's an autoimmune condition that most people have absolutely no idea that it's autoimmune when they first see it. When if it attacks the lungs, it could be asthma. There's another one that most people have no idea is autoimmune. It could attack the nerves, it could attack the GI tract, it can even attack the blood. So we have to know what is the cause when we look at this. And you can see at the top that there are some triggers, stress, hormones, metals, food, antigens, pesticides, and poisons. But I want to go back to the fire analogy, because that is just really honestly just such a good analogy, because this is a spectrum. Okay, we have to be on a spectrum when it comes to autoimmune conditions, just like the fire. If I go to this next slide, there you go. So you can see this. So you start off healthy. That's over to the left side of the screen. You start off healthy. And so as time goes along, you would move to the right here. As time goes along, you also lead to more tissue damage. That's why over on the right side, the purple side, it says degeneration or deformation. That's permanent tissue damage. So how this starts, though, is right there with the yellow. There are triggers. So if I go back, you'll see stress, hormones, metals, food antigens, pesticides, and poisons. We're going to talk about what those triggers are. But something creates a trigger. So think about an allergy. Something gets in and your immune system decides we've got to attack this, right? So that's good, right? You want your immune system to be on high alert, but you don't want it to be overactive. So it's attacking things, it's attacking allergies, say it's attacking pollen, say it's attacking gluten, say it's attacking, you know, horsehair, or dander or something, or a virus or infection or stress, but you're activating your immune system. Then you'd move into the pre-symptomatic phase. I'd say that's unfortunately, you know, where probably most people are. They have immune activation. If we did an immune system test on them, we could measure that they're producing antibodies, but they don't have any symptoms yet. That orange phase, that's the scary place to be. You know, our kids might be down on the green, a lot of kids in the yellow. They've got allergies, they've got asthma. Maybe they're starting to get psoriasis, maybe they're starting to get eczema. That's a red flag. That's like seeing a small fire in the woods and be like, oh, it's just a small fire. Well, small fires turn to big fires, right? So you gotta put that thing out. So over on the green, you know, you might be a match. Over the yellow to the orange, you're a campfire. You know, that can be put out, but it's going to be tough. Maybe into the red, you're a burning building. And so when you're a burning building, you know, if your house has ever caught fire, based on the extent of the damage, some of it's going to be irreversible. Maybe the house is still able to be salvaged. If you're already into the symptomatic phase, you've already suffered from an autoimmune condition for years, if not decades, maybe everything could be salvaged, maybe not. But the more damage that has been done, the harder it is to salvage, just like the fire. And the sooner that you start, the easier it is to salvage. So that spectrum there is really, really important, that you realize that everybody is somewhere different. Even if you don't have any symptoms, even if your kids don't have any symptoms, you have to start taking care of it right away so that it doesn't move into the orange. It doesn't move into the red phase. So with that being said, you know, what causes this? What causes the immune activation in the first place? And then what causes it to continually be overactivated and overactivated and overactivated until it just goes completely haywire and starts having bigger problems? Well, you know, if you look at, you know, you start reading a lot of this stuff out there, you know, The Autoimmune Solution is a great book here by Dr. Amy Meyer. She's an MD. Sorry, I have a light on this. But this is a really great book. And there's a lot of experts out there that teach this in a very similar way. But all the causes, they're almost always the same. So when you look at what are the causes, you see three things. Okay, and so we use the three-legged stool analogy, but I'm going to show you another one in just a second, because the thing about a three-legged stool is that, you know, if you understand the analogy, you have to have all three legs. You can't pull out one leg or your stool is going to tip over, right? And so the three legs are your genes, your gut, and your environment. Okay, and I'm going to go into each of those in detail, but your environment, I put toxic in parentheses here, But you know, you can see that there's a lot that goes into that. It's not just your stress level, even though that's a huge part of it. It's not just your toxins, even though that's a huge part of it. It's your diet, it's your heavy metals, it's your chemicals, it's your mold, it's any underlying infections. It is your stress, it's your mental stress, it's your job, it's your exercise level, it's all of these things. And so I would not categorize these things all as even, but for an analogy's sake, you know, the analogy is great. But here's the analogy that I like better, because it is really a confusing, never really straightforward answer here. And they do play different roles. So you see there in the bottom right, your genes, your genetics. There is a genetic component to autoimmune disease. There is genetic susceptibility. But the reason that we remade this image is because your genes do not control everything. Not even close. The modern research and science shows that actually about 95 to 98% of your risk for disease is developed from your environment. Okay, so that's about 2 to 5% that's developed through your genes. Now with autoimmune diseases, that number might be higher. I've seen it as high as 20% that might be influenced by your genes. But still, if you're familiar with the science today of what's called epigenetics, you know that we all have good genes and we have bad genes, every single one of us. So just because your mom had rheumatoid arthritis or your dad had type 1 diabetes or your aunt or somebody had this disease does not mean that you are destined. Your genes are not your destiny. You have quite a bit of control over that. Now, if your mom, your sister, your aunt, your grandma, and your niece all have rheumatoid arthritis, you are at a higher risk level, absolutely, without a doubt. But your genes don't control everything. But that is one of the causes. So what happens? You have good genes and you have bad genes. Those genes have to be triggered. Okay, the next one is toxins. And that is a huge one. That is your environment. So not just toxins as in chemicals or xenobiotics or haptens or, you know, things that your body can't recognize, but also, you know, toxic sugar, toxic stress, mental stress, that's physical stress, that's chemical stress, that's emotional stress. You know, stress is stress to your body, and stress is toxic. So that can trigger a bad gene. You put a stressful environment, you put a lot of toxins on top of bad genes, and you're more likely to trigger it. Then the third one that oftentimes has to be, it literally has to be there. You know, you can't really find an autoimmune disease without a gut problem. Okay, so everybody with autoimmune disease, basically by definition, will have a gut issue. Okay, and we're gonna talk about that. So the gut, we're gonna get into this, but the gut, you know, you think about this army, and I want you to think about this analogy of the biblical times army. You know, their job is to defend the community, to defend the city. Well, your gut is like your wall. Okay, I'm not talking about Donald Trump's wall between us and Mexico. I'm talking about a wall that actually, you know, did something back in the day and kept bad people out, kept the enemy out. Now, that wall was not impermeable, right? If there's trade that happened. If people needed to get in, they could. If people needed to get out, they could. It wasn't impermeable, but you had to pass the gate. You had to get checked out. You know, you had to be approved to come through. And that's how our gut is. You know, our gut, if you think about it, your gut literally, close these slides. Yeah, your gut, you know, it starts at your mouth and goes all the way to your anus, and that is your gut. And that is outside of your body. That's really, really weird to think about. But the things that start in your mouth and end up in your toilet, they never get into your body. They are outside of your body. The gut is the wall. And digestion really starts in the mouth. Your teeth are incredibly important for digestion. Your saliva is incredibly important for digestion. So when we start talking about undigested food particles, that starts in the mouth. But your gut and your gut lining, that is the wall, keeping the good, letting the good things in. Okay, so good things have to get in, right? Vitamins, minerals, calories, nutrients, enzymes. All the important things have to get in, but the waste has to get out, right? And so when bad things start being able to cross the gut lining, that is a problem, because they get into the city, they get into our community, they get past the wall, and then the army attacks them, right? And when the army attacks them, at first it's a good thing. You want your army to attack foreign invaders, but it starts going haywire. So the gut is an incredibly important part. So all three of those are incredibly important. But, you know, it's kind of jangled like this because it's not that simple. You know, it's not three perfect circles that form together. And you know, when they all hit just right, you get an autoimmune disease. You could be, you know, more geared towards, you know, you're just destroying your gut, and that could lead to an autoimmune condition. You could have good genes and just be severely, severely toxic. That could do it. So it's a combination, and it really is a puzzle. Autoimmune really, really is a puzzle. And so you're looking for pieces of the puzzle that are helping put this thing together. And these three are by far the biggest pieces of the puzzle. So the next thing that I want to go into is, you know, really what do we do after we know that we have autoimmune, or after these things are triggering, you know, what's the next step? And the next step is really, you know, solution, you know, going into to the solutions. And that's really the focus of tonight. You can feel free to Google, you can feel free to get a textbook, you can feel free to look up. If you want to know the immunology behind autoimmune, by all means, feel free to look it up. I feel like the more that you know, the more that you're empowered to keep learning more. But at the same time, what I would say is it doesn't matter, you know, whether or not you are a Hashimoto's patient and your brother's an ulcerative colitis patient, you're both autoimmune patients. And that is exactly how it should be treated. You know, in this book, The Autoimmune Solution, and many others like it, you know, there's not a solution for Hashimoto's and a solution for rheumatoid arthritis and a solution for celiac disease. There are just solutions. Okay, and these solutions, like I said, with that spectrum that we looked at, they're not just autoimmune solutions. They're inflammation solutions. They're not just for people who are on the spectrum who have been diagnosed. They are literally super, super important for every single person on this call and every single person that you know. So I want to go right in to these solutions. Pull up my slides again here. So five real health solutions for autoimmune disease. Okay, so solution number one, change your food. Okay, and this talk, I mean, this talk could have been called 99 things to do to heal autoimmunity, and the first 96 could have been change your food. This one is one that I'm just incredibly passionate about, because if you don't change your food, and nothing else is gonna happen. I mean, literally nothing else is gonna happen. And so many people today, like, what can I take? What can I do? And they just want a pill solution, whether it's, you know, a supplement like we have, or it's a medication. They want the easy solution, and there just is no easy solution without changing your diet. And I don't think changing your diet is really that difficult, but we're just so resistant to it because we've gotten so used to the standard American diet. But you literally have to change your diet. This is like trying to put out a fire. Thinking, my gosh, I don't know why this fire won't go out, as you're pouring gas on it. You are literally pouring gasoline on your fire with some of these foods. I'm going to show you the research is really clear that they cause leaky gut, that they cause inflammation, that they lead to autoimmune conditions. And when you really start to see the research, you start to see the list, you start to see exactly what's going on. I want you to really think about this. If my kids, if somebody were to give them a processed food, what I see in my brain is like, you know, somebody coming up to a screened in porch and poking holes into it in my kids' guts, because that is quite literally what happens. So let's talk about that, changing your food screen. So toxic foods, you know, so toxic foods, I put this in there to remind me that, you know, there are toxic foods. Okay, so sugar, it actually is a food. It has calories, your body gets energy from it. Same with hydrogenated oils. They're bad. They're actually horrible. Both of those are pouring gas on your fire. They're incredibly inflammatory, but they are actually food. So there are actual foods that destroy your gut bacteria, destroy your gut lining and cause leaky gut and food allergies. Okay, so those are real, real foods. Okay, we're going to talk about those. What are the most common allergens? What are the most common things that are poking holes in the gut? What are some of the biggest proteins we want to avoid? But those are the real foods, okay? And I want to touch on those briefly because there's a difference between real foods and fake foods. And the fake foods are really the challenge here when you start to look into what people are eating. And what happens here is, well, I'll show you in a second, actually. But you know, I've written an article and there's a podcast episode, and it's called 7 Food Additives That Cause Leaky Gut and Autoimmunity. And this isn't any of my words. This comes from the Journal of Autoimmunity Reviews. Okay, and so this is a journal that, if you're familiar with what a review is, it means that this journal, they didn't take 20 people and feed them this and take 20 people and feed them that and see the difference. They didn't run a study. They review all these studies. So they review all the literature that's out there on autoimmune disease, on leaky gut, and do a literature review and then publish this review paper. And they've got a lot, the journal Autoimmunity Reviews, that's all it is. But this one paper they wrote is called 7 Food Additives. At least that's what my article is called. It's called something along those lines. But it talks about 7 food additives, how ubiquitous they are in our food supply. They're everywhere. And they go through exactly how those have been shown through the current scientific research, without a doubt, to cause leaky gut, to cause intestinal permeability, to poke holes in your gut lining and lead to autoimmune disease. Okay, so those are things, sugar and salt, those are the top two. These are added sugars, okay? So high fructose corn syrup and just the sugar that's in the standard American diet is insane. It throws off your gut bacteria, feeds bad bacteria or yeast, can overgrow on a high sugar diet, but it literally not only overgrows the bacteria, but pokes holes right in the gut. Salt was the other one. Okay, and I'm not talking about your Himalayan sea salt that you sprinkle on your dinner. We're talking about added salt in your processed foods. I forget what the number is, but it's staggering. The percentage higher that there is processed or that there's salt in our processed foods than in the food you prepare yourself. It's something staggering, like 1,500 times more salt. It might be 150 times. So I don't quote me on that. But it's a considerable amount more salt in our processed foods than in our regular foods that we prepare ourselves. So just right there, salt and sugar, get rid of those. But then it goes into all the other additives, the chemicals, the things that you won't find on your label. It goes into things like emulsifiers, surfactants, nanoparticles, all this technological jargon that goes in meat glues, texturizers. You don't know that your meat that's been sitting on the shelf that got shipped to you from 5 states away from an animal that was killed months ago, or maybe not months, but a long time ago, it still looks pretty good. That's not natural. That's been texturized. It's been colored. There's meat glues. There's things that they add to the meats to give it different texture, which is disgusting. But when you really start looking into the food industry, that's why documentaries like Food Inc. and stuff really are disgusting, because this stuff is being added into our foods and it causes leaky gut. So when we look at this, how this happens is, so the top there, these are your diet and your environmental factors. So let's take, for example, sugar right now. So that's a dietary factor. So let's say you eat the standard American diet. Not only is your blood sugar imbalanced, which can also lead to big issues, which is going to be our webinar in December, by the way. But it leads to an imbalanced microbiota, which is your microbiome. That's the bacteria in your gut. And hopefully a lot of you have heard of this today, at least a little bit, because it's starting to be common knowledge with probiotics. Your microbiome is really important. They're finding it's at the root of most diseases today. So what I don't want you to take away from this is, oh my gosh, I need to go out and take a probiotic. We're going to talk about that later when we get into the solutions. That might not be the best thing. You could actually be doing more harm. But the environmental factors lead to an imbalanced microbiome. And when you get an imbalanced microbiome, your gut becomes inflamed. Then when your gut becomes inflamed, things can actually poke through that gut and get into your bloodstream. When they get into your bloodstream, if you just go down a few steps of the stair step here, your immune system creates an attack against it, and it can cross-react with various tissues. So it can cross-react with thyroid tissue, it can cross-react with joint tissue, it can cross-react with digestive tissue, and then you get multi-organ tissue inflammation and autoimmune. So that's how that happens, starting from your food, leading to autoimmune. And here's a chart courtesy of Cyrex Laboratories, the world's leaders in autoimmune testing. These are the autoimmune disorders associated with just your food reactivity. Okay, so Crohn's disease, ulcerative colitis, celiac, non-celiac gluten sensitivity. So your digestive ones are at the top. As you work down, you hit, you know, some more musculoskeletal things, stiff person syndrome, ataxia, mixed connective tissue. Then you get more of the arthritises, your lupus, your scleroderma, your rheumatoid, Addison's disease, a horrible, horrible autoimmune disease of the adrenal glands where your body just can't adapt to stress is a really bad one. Autoimmune thyroiditis, type 1 diabetes, myocarditis, so autoimmune heart disease, bone autoimmunity, liver, alopecia, all these are linked to your food supply. So there's no diet for you know, type 1 diabetes. There's no diet for Addison's. There's no diet for Crohn's. Like we keep saying, there's an umbrella diet to look at all of these things together. Now, when you look at our food supply, I just want to show you this example of, you know, where is this stuff coming from? And so it says, with today's fast pace, can't wait for it, got to have it now lifestyle, many kitchens in the U.S. are stocked with prepackaged, microwavable, heat it and eat it foodstuffs. And if it's not prepackaged, microwavable TV dinners, it's crackers, it's cookies, it's all these things that are just horrible hydrogenated oils, grains, and then just a bunch of this junk. Okay, so look at this. This is just, I don't even know what this is. If I had to guess by looking at the ingredients, I would guess like some kind of candy. But let's go through this. Sugar, first ingredient. So you know that the first ingredient is in there in the highest, you know, by weight, in there the most. So the most is sugar, then water, then there's corn syrup, which is sugar. Then there's enriched bleached wheat flour. So you might think enriched is good. It's got your B vitamins, but no, that's complete junk. Partially hydrogenated vegetable oil, soybean oil, canola oil, cottonseed oil, complete junk, really massively inflammatory. So fueling gut inflammation, fueling cellular inflammation from these hydrogenated oils, one of the top ingredients in there. And it will be in anything. You know, you flip over your food and you're going to find it in most things. My gosh, as I go down the list. And it even says, one needs an advanced degree in chemistry to understand this. High fructose corn syrup. Then we go to things like, let's stop at some big ones. Polysorbate 60. Okay, polysorbate, that's an ingredient that first off is in that article that I talked about, seven food additives that cause autoimmunity. It's also something that's in our vaccines. So if you're, you know, an interested parent that wants to be educated on what you're putting into your kids' bodies, you know, you might not put it in there with this food. Do you know that you're injecting it? Soy lecithin, that's another one that's on that list of food additives that cause autoimmune disease. Some of these others are just complete crap. I can't even talk about them. Natural and artificial flavors, that can be a code word for MSG, which is a neurotoxin, neurocellular excitotoxin, monosodium glutamate. And then the colorings. So the colorings are horrible, linked to a lot of things, probably the biggest one being hyperactivity in children and other neurological conditions like that. So you have to avoid these toxic foods. And one of the rules that we always, you know, encourage and live by is really, this is probably my favorite rule. And I mean, honestly, if you live by this rule, 90% of people are going to get 90% better 90% of the time. Eat food by God, not food by man. Okay, and hopefully that doesn't sound like rocket science. You know, this is how we were designed. And a lot of our science today with the, you know, paleo diet and different things, you know, we're learning, we're going back to nature. We're going back to the way that we were designed. We've had a lot of amazing technological advances in the last, you know, couple hundred years, but we're starting to learn that maybe some of this stuff didn't need to be advanced. So eat food by God, not food by man. Eat food that grew on a plant, not food that was made in the plant. You know, like you take an apple, for example, and I was thinking about this earlier. You know, what's the ingredients list on an apple? There isn't one, even though it has vitamin A, has vitamin C, has enzymes, minerals, cofactors, it has so much good stuff in it. But there is no ingredients list. For things natural, there shouldn't be an ingredients list. So if you're even checking your ingredients list already, you know, you're starting off on the wrong foot. But obviously, you know, today a lot of the things we have are conveniently packaged for us. But don't eat the packaged, processed, crap food, because you are literally pouring gas on a fire when it comes to autoimmune. You're fueling inflammation. So that's your typical food label there, and go in your pantry, probably is where you keep all this junk. Flip it over and read the labels, and tell me if that's something that you think sounds healthy or something that you think sounds like a food by God. Now, like this one, if they put apple in there, it would just say apple. So if you see that, it's not bad. Or if there's five ingredients or less, not bad. But start looking at these things, you'll see how massive of a toxic burden you're getting every week. So the toxins you've got to get rid of, those are the fake foods, but you've also got to look at your real foods. And we're going to spend the most time on this. So when we talk about five action steps, they're not all going to be this long. Number one is 75% of your battle for health and for autoimmune conditions especially. But so looking at your real foods, you have to eliminate your allergenic food. So the first step is to get rid of the fake food. Start eating a real food diet. When you start eating a real food diet, you know, literally 75% of you, your symptoms are going to go away. That's why something like a Whole 30 is just such an amazing eating plan. It's not rocket science. It's an eating plan that I've taught for the last 5 years. It's cut out gluten, cut out grains, cut out dairy, cut out other allergenic or inflammatory foods. But you know, they've done a great job culturally of getting people to stick to it and getting amazing results. So starting here is a great place to start. But then once you're eating real foods, you got to look at your allergenic foods. Okay, so gluten is the number one. That's the number one food sensitivity. And I will be completely honest to say that, you know, a few years ago, I was one of these people that said, why in the heck is gluten-free so popular? Like, this is a bandwagon. People are jumping on this bandwagon so that they can market because they know that there's a big market out there. And it still is. You know, gluten-free brownies, that's junk. Gluten-free bread, that's junk. Gluten-free pizza, you know, that's junk. You know, a lot of gluten-free things are junk. But also at the same time, I really, really think that gluten is something that everybody should be avoiding. I literally don't know. So I'm thinking about it as I'm talking to you guys, which I shouldn't, but I don't know if my girls have ever had gluten. They maybe have, but dairy is another one, you know, very, very rarely or occasionally, but cut those things out. And I'm going to explain why. Then there are others. So gluten and dairy are the two most common food allergens. And so what that means is that when you eat these foods, they are crossing through your leaky gut. I'll show you some pictures later of what that looks like when I talk about healing the gut. But those particles, those gluten particles, those dairy particles, those proteins are actually crossing the gut, getting into your body. Remember, I said your gut is actually technically outside of your body. They're getting into your body. They're getting through the wall, and your army is defending against them. So those are the big ones. But some of the others, eggs, common allergen, soy is a huge one. Legumes, that's beans. Okay, so like Whole 30, for example, it cuts out beans. Well, beans are kind of a gray area because they can be inflammatory for a lot of people, but for a lot of people, they're not. So, you know, you might need to do a customized elimination diet, or you might even need to do some food sensitivity testing. That is by far the easiest way, is to test this. You know, Cyrex Labs is the world's leader in autoimmune testing, whether it's, you know, you can test for leaky blood-brain barrier, you can test for a neurologic autoimmune response. But through this food test, they test over 180 different food antigens. And so they test different things, but what they do is they test them cooked, they test them uncooked. They test foods, but they also test things like artificial colorings, things like meat glues, things like lectins or pectins or components of your food that your body can actually react and respond to. So how does this happen? You know, because you might be thinking, you know, biblically, food by God, food by man, you know, you're thinking back in biblical times, the army and stuff. If you're stuck back there in your head, you might be thinking, well, we used to be able to eat wheat. You know, the grain is the staff of life, you know, all these things that people have been able to eat wheat for years. So why can't they do it now? What is the problem? What has stopped? What has changed? And literally, you know, it has changed. So our wheat itself has actually changed. There's a lot of hybridization and things like that that has changed. But the other thing that's changed is, show you this picture here. Oh, actually, I'll show you this one first. Well, this is the wheat proteomes. This is everything that just wheat sensitivity, wheat alone, has been linked to. Okay, so this is probably all the food ones that we looked at before. MS, autoimmune thyroid, Addison's, alopecia, it's a hair problem, you know, losing type 1 diabetes. You know, most people would have no idea that that was an autoimmune condition where your immune system is actually attacking the islet cells of your pancreas, causing it to not be able to produce insulin. Arthritis, autism, migraines, epilepsy. So these are all things that have been linked to wheat reactions and having an immune response to wheat. But the way that this works is up here at the top, okay, so this is wheat. It looks like a feather, right? So that one on the right and at the top is a good old school wheat, okay? And so your immune system, at one point in life, it got familiarized with wheat. That's called oral tolerance. That's when we start adding foods into our kids. And then as we add them in, their immune system gets used to them. You know, so you picture the wall again. It's, you know, somebody's coming in and they're bringing a horse and buggy for something, and you say, okay, I know you. You've been here before. Come on in, right? So he's friendly. And that's what we expect. But now the bottom here, the bottom feather-looking thing is wheat that's been sprayed with a chemical, okay? And that's all of our wheat today. It's been sprayed with glyphosate or Roundup. It's Roundup ready. And that is the concern with our genetically modified foods, with our, you know, just massive, massive, massive use of Roundup. Yeah, I mean, Google this. We don't have time to go into it, but Google it and just look at the images and look at the Roundup use and look at the charts with Roundup use compared to, you know, the rise of autoimmune diseases or the rise of irritable bowel diseases or the rise of autism or the rise of almost any inflammatory condition. As we've used more glyphosate, our conditions have just skyrocketed and gone up and up and up. So things literally have changed. The wheat has changed. So now we get this new wheat. It comes in with a toxin attached to it. So that is, you know, the little red hat there. So the blue thing, this is your immune system. So your green immune over on the right, he's kind of like the gatekeeper. He's checking it out and he says, okay, I know you, wheat. So look at the top. It says, who is this guy? He looks familiar. This is Weedy. Remember him? We met him when we were 6 months old. Don't attack him. But now this new wheat comes in, comes through the gate, comes through the wall, which, you know, if the wall was sealed, it would never get through. But, you know, who is this guy? He looks like Weedy, but he's not Weedy. Look at his hat. Weedy never wears a hat. I don't think we know this guy. Attack, attack, attack. Okay, and so that is exactly how this happens. Your body begins to start attacking wheat. So your immune system starts going haywire. But then the wheat can cross-react with other tissues. And here's the scary thing, the best example of wheat. Wheat actually closely resembles thyroid tissue. So when your body gets used to attacking wheat, it's constantly bombarded with wheat, wheat, wheat. So your immune system is hyperactive. It's like, you know, a soldier that maybe is asleep, but he's ready to be woken up. He knows that something's going to happen. There's a lot of action going on. Whereas, you know, if the immune system isn't very active, or it's only active when it needs to be, you know, the soldiers are at home. They're resting when there's not a war, when there's not a battle. But here they're overactive. They're just being called on all the time. So they get up and they accidentally start attacking thyroid. They think that thyroid is wheat. they think that wheat is wearing a hat, and they start attacking the thyroid. So that's the best example. That is, you know, once again, another nutshell of autoimmunity. But that's how this happens. You know, why did we used to be able to handle wheat? Why did we used to be able to handle milk? Why do we used to be able to handle these things? Well, it's because of the chemicals that are attached to them now. So you look at milk and you look at the other big allergen, you know, and the research is pretty clear on this. You give milk to a child within their first few weeks of life, and their risk for asthma and allergies skyrockets, like through the roof skyrockets. And when you think about this, I'll close this down again. We use this analogy, and it makes perfect sense. We're talking about proteins. You know, the milk proteins are what are attacked, the wheat proteins. Well, mother's milk, okay, so let's use a ball, for example. Mother's milk proteins might be like a baseball. Okay, so pretty decent size, but they're smaller. You know, there's ping pong balls, there's pinballs, there's smaller ones. There's also bigger. There's basketballs, there's volleyballs, you know, et cetera. So mother's milk is a small protein. Cow's milk is cow size. It's cow size protein. So you're talking about a leaky gut that has holes through it. You know, picture a screen or a cheesecloth. You know, if I poke my hand through with this pen, it's going to make a different size hole than if I poke my hand through with this highlighter, right? Because one's bigger. And so the milk protein pokes a bigger hole through. So if there's a hole already in the gut and the milk protein passes through it, it's going to create more leaky gut symptoms. So when you look at all the things that milk has been, you know, associated with, it's autism, you know, so gluten-free, casein-free diet has been, this is old knowledge to people in the autistic community. Gluten-free, casein-free diet has been, you know, standard of care in the alternative world for years. Same with probiotics and fish oil and some of that stuff that's evolved quite a bit. But a lot of stuff that we're talking about has been known for a long time in the autism community. Epithelial permeability, that is a leaky gut, is exactly what that means. But here's the thing, you can have leaky blood-brain barrier. You can have leaky kidneys. You can have leaky tissues. Celiac disease, Crohn's disease, multiple sclerosis, lupus, RA. So, you know, a lot of the major ones are linked to milk. So that's the second one that you have to cut out. You have to cut out these common food allergens. You know, looking at a transitional one, you know, goat's milk. We get a lot of questions on goat's milk for our kids. You know, is goat's milk okay? And what I'll tell people is, you know, think about the size of a goat protein. Is it closer to mom's protein, or is it closer to a cow? Well, it's closer to the size and weight and things of humans. So the proteins are actually smaller. It's a great, you know, transitional one. But obviously, mother's milk is God's superfood. It's the best food on the planet for a baby. They shouldn't really be taking in anything else unless, you know, in our case, you know, we have twins and we weren't able to continue breastfeeding. So then you have to look for another solution. But otherwise, that's your best bet. So milk, then the other one, another one, like I said, with others back here, eggs, soy, legumes, nightshades. So then you have to get into more of an elimination diet and really find out which of these you're having a response to and what you need to cut out there. So like here's lectins, for example, and lectins are a component of like lentils, of soy, of legumes, of black beans, brown beans, you know. So, and this is the problem with vegetarian diets, massive problem with vegetarian diets. Vegetarian, you know, you can have a healthy vegetarian diet, but most people don't. They switch to a vegetarian diet. So what is it really rich in? It's really rich in grains. It's really rich in gluten. And even non-gluten grains are inflammatory. They turn to omega-6s. They boost your inflammatory omega-6s in your bodies, which lowers your omega-3s. Massive, massive, massive problem when it comes to disease. And that's really, really common in vegetarians. They're eating a lot of grains, but then they're eating a lot of beans, they're eating a lot of legumes. That's where they're getting their protein, that's where they're getting their calories from, and they're fueling inflammation. So it's not impossible, right? I mean, we preach a plant-based diet, a plant-based paleo diet, but I am not a vegetarian, nor do I support being a vegetarian unless you're really educated on it and you know where to get these things from. But anyway, lectins are in those things. That's why beans can be inflammatory. You look at some of these things, there's other things on this list like infertility or your classical allergy or nephritis, inflammation of your kidneys and your nephrons of your kidneys, gut dysbiosis. So they fuel lectins and beans, they fuel gut inflammation. That's one of the issues. Intestinal barrier dysfunction, that is leaky gut. So there's all these different foods that you have to look at to know where they are coming from, and you have to change. And now, like I said, we're spending the most time on this because if you can go home with one thing tonight, if you can go home with one take-home thing, it's change your food and stop eating crap. Just stop eating fake food. You know, start growing food in your garden or buying it from a farmer's market or buying, you know, real meat, real vegetables. Vegetables are pretty easy. You know, you can get organic or you can get conventional. And look up, you know, we have a lot of great resources actually on our website. You can get a veggies cheat sheet that has the dirty dozen and the clean 15 in there. But for the most part, just start eating real food. You're going to make a lot of headway. If you need to know more about this, you know, if you don't know much about your nutrition, you're like, my gosh, where do I start? I had, you know, McDonald's breakfast burrito for breakfast, and I had Hardee's for lunch, and now I'm about to have, you know, lean cuisine for dinner or something. If you're starting from ground zero, go back onto our website, go back onto our podcast. I would start with the Total Food Makeover, then start listening to episodes about sugars, about fats, about inflammation, and start learning about this. Because like I said, you know, because I've seen the research, you know, and there's studies out there that show slides, cultures of your gut cells, and they'll show them before and your cells are like this. They'll expose them to gluten, and 15 minutes later, they're like this. So this is, you know, there's no controversy here. It's well-documented scientific research today that anytime, you know, you try to feed my kid cake, I'm going to have a problem with it. You try to feed him a chemical, I'm going to have a problem with it. And I know that, like, maybe my mom and my sisters might be on this webinar, and now you know why. Because every single time, this is what it causes and what it leads to. And I take that really, really seriously. So step number two, after you have changed your food, is to detoxify your life. Okay, and I say your life because it's not just about detoxing your body. You know, you can dump a bucket, but if you leave the hose on filling it up, it's gonna fill up again. And that's what we always talk about, is the toxic bucket here. You know, is your bucket overflowing with toxins? So detoxify your life. So that starts with changing out, you know, your environment. Change out your kitchen tools. Get rid of your nonstick cookware, your PFOA Teflon cookware. Get rid of your personal care products. That is a huge one. You know, you look back at the chart where we saw that women are so much more affected than men with these autoimmune conditions, and you look at what are the differences, and obviously hormones are the biggest difference. But the other difference is the toxic exposures. It's crazy when it comes to personal care products how many toxic exposures women have every single day. It's in the multiple hundreds when they've studied it. Women put on an average of, I believe it's 31 toxic chemicals a day, or no, 31 toxic personal care products, and it was an average of in the 200, you know, chemicals. And you know, they've studied this, that this is getting into your bloodstream, and not only you, it's getting into your baby's bloodstream. You know, so we've done the study or done the podcast and webisodes and stuff about the Red Cross and Environmental Working Group study where they tested umbilical cords, and they found 210 toxic chemicals in umbilical cord blood. So you have to change this stuff. It's not negotiable. Everybody has to change it. So what do we use? You know, that's a question that we get all the time. One of the things that I'll mention, you know, if you're local, we have a great patient who makes a great local product. It's called ABBA's Set Apart Remedies. It's a great lotion. You know, honestly, our patients with eczema, with psoriasis, they say that I've tried everything. I've never used anything better. And a great example, because I just had a patient leave. most patients with a skin condition, you've probably been prescribed Cetaphil, the number one doctor, dermatologist prescribed lotion. This thing is like, we've done episodes on the toxic top five personal care products, and that is the Cetaphil ingredients list. I mean, it has these things in it, like it has three different types of parabens. It has, it's not SLL, it's propylene glycol. And this is dermatologist recommended. So you got to get rid of these things. The other company that we use, and that's ABBA's, that's, you know, here locally, not available, you know, online or worldwide, but an amazing product. But the other one is Pure Haven Essentials. This is an amazing, amazing line. I brush my teeth with it. My wife uses it as a makeup remover. It's an extensive line. And, you know, especially for women, you know, toothbrush is about the only personal care product I use other than some gel in my hair. But other than that, you know, I don't use a lot. But for my wife, you know, she's got her Pure Haven Essentials lineup. She's got her makeup remover. She's got her eye cream. She's got her, I don't even remember what they all are, but they've got a full extensive line. If you're interested, send us an email, ask us about that. We'd be happy to teach you about that. But you can just in one fell swoop, get rid of all your old personal care products and switch over to, you know, okay, my computer just died. Hopefully everybody is still on here. Jamie, give me a text, please, and let me know that everybody's still on here. It's plugged in and it just shut off. How convenient. So back to what we were talking about. Detoxify your life. So change your stuff over. Then after you get the stuff out of your house, filter your air, filter your water, and then look deeper into things like heavy metals. You could have hidden infections. You could have mold. There are different things that cause this, and you got to look deeper to where these toxins are coming from. But then the next step after you detoxify your life and you get rid of some of that junk, the next step is then you got to detoxify your body. Okay, and that is the most important thing. You got to get rid of the stuff, but your bucket might still be full. So detox your body. So what that looks like is support your liver. Sorry, I'm getting confirmed that you guys can hear me. Good. So what that looks like is you need to support your liver. You need to support your gut. You need to support your kidneys. Those are your downstream detox pathways. But some of you out there have probably done something like a gut cleanse or a liver cleanse or a flush. And those things are great. Those things really are. They're really good. But they're never getting upstream into your cells. So you really have to, you know, this isn't like Google a detox and do a 5 or 10 day detox. You have to get to the cells. You have to use true binders. So I don't know if this is backwards for you guys, but this is called bind. And it's quite literally, it says toxin elimination. It binds toxins and gets rid of them. This is another one that we use in the office. It's called intracellular glutathione, and that's your body's actual natural detoxifier. It's how it detoxifies metals and other xenobiotics and things. And then this is another one that is called cytodetox. And so these are, block that light. So cytodetox, but that's a true binder, and it's actually the first true binder, true zeolite that can cross your gut line and cross your blood-brain barrier, cross actually into your cells, bind toxins, and get rid of them. So it's actually an awesome product there that's only been around for about 6 months. But that's what you have to do, is you have to do, you know, a little more concerted effort to go into your body and start detoxing. But that's the number two solution for autoimmune. So once you change your diet, then get the toxins out. And what happens here, and the reason that this is so important, is these toxins, they get into your cell and they continually drive and fuel inflammation. Okay, so our next step is going to be, you know, healing your gut. So I'm just giving you a preview there. It's going to be healing your gut. But I'm using that as a segue, because what I've had quite a few times is I've had people come into me and they're very knowledgeable. You know, they've looked this stuff up. They've read about the GAPS diet, or they've heard about this program or this protocol. And oftentimes they've tried it and they haven't gotten well. GAPS is a great example. It's a great diet. It's a great, great book. But if you've done something for over a year and you're still not, you know, not completely well, I shouldn't say, you know, GAPS diet, right in the first paragraph, I think it says you can expect multiple years, but you should be noticing some results. I don't think, in my opinion, it takes a year to heal a leaky gut, especially when you're in your 20s or your 30s, unless there are toxins. Because when there are toxins, you can't ever heal. You know, you heal it and it comes back. You heal candida overgrowth in your gut and it comes back. You decrease inflammation in your gut and it comes back. That's what toxins do. So for anybody that has a mysterious, you know, I've tried 10 different things and I felt a little bit better, but it's always come back. You have to look deeper into the cells and you have to get the toxins out, because otherwise they will stay there. You know, things like mercury and lead, they're multi-generational. And what they've shown with some of these toxins is crazy, with the multi-generational studies, like with mercury. They took animals, they gave them mercury, and they looked at their offspring, right? Okay, so their first generation offspring were pretty normal. They thought, okay, well, gosh, mercury doesn't affect generations. The kids were fine, of these mice or rats or whatever they use. But then they had children. They had babies. Another generation, and that's when they found it. So it actually skipped a generation. So some of these toxins, especially the metals that store in your nervous system tissue, that store in your brain, that store in your bone, they store in these deeper tissues. The only time they start to come out is if you start to lose these tissues. So like osteoporosis, your toxins start coming out of your bones, your lead levels will be off the roof if you have lead and you're in osteoporosis. Or the other time, pregnancy. Right. Okay. That's really, really scary. You have high levels of lead. You have high levels of mercury, these heavy metals that have an affinity for the bone. When you start losing bone mineral density during your pregnancy, those toxins start to recirculate and they're going into baby right there. So a huge thing, detoxing, you know, it's one of my main focuses. And number three, healing your gut. Okay, so this is, you know, what we've been talking about, that your gut is your primary physical defense. It's literally the only thing, and you know, it is the only thing, and the defense, the wall, you know, your wall protecting your city is only one brick thick. Okay, so it's only one cell thick. Your gut lining is only one cell thick. So any breach in that lining means that toxins and proteins can enter the bloodstream, create an immune response, and lead to an autoimmune disease. So that's this chart here illustrates it really well, that my friend Dr. Axe has made. And so it shows the different things that can cross through that can cause it. This is what we've been talking about, your stress. That's your physical, your chemical, your emotional stress. They all do it. Stress hormones break down the gut lining. Toxins is what we were just talking about. Food particles, your little green things there. Your drugs, your medications. You know, the best example, the two best examples actually, one being antibiotics. Okay, so we know biotic means life. Pro means, yeah, we're all for it. Anti means we're against it. So antibiotic, we're anti-life. It goes in, it kills bacteria. Bad bacteria, right? That's a good thing if you've got Giardia or you've got some, you know, bad bacteria that's causing a disease. Maybe it's a good thing, but it also kills all the good stuff. That's why probiotics are so important, is because antibiotics wipe out the good stuff too. So drugs can affect it. So what happens is there's gut inflammation. So this top part where you see this red box, it says GI inflammation. That's the inside of your gut tract or outside of your body. Okay, so where your digestion is, basically where your poop is. Your food's going through there, it's being broken down and it's getting excreted out the other end. This is that one cell wall. Okay, so on the left here, you can see that wall is nice and tight and thick. It's been built by a good mason, you know, it's solid, nothing can get through there. When it becomes inflamed, these things can break through. And so you see actually literally a picture here of a food breaking through, then it leads to food intolerances, then it leads to immune system issues, then it leads to autoimmune diseases. So everybody is somewhere along this spectrum, starting with your food intolerances, and that's a great, great picture. It's a much better picture than this, but it's the same thing. It starts with your diet and your environmental factors, causes gut inflammation, other things happen, yada, yada, yada. Your immune system reacts and it leads to autoimmunity, and everybody's somewhere on that spectrum. Here's another picture of it that's a little bit harder to show, but it shows a little more detail. And this one's looking at lectins, like we talked about beans. So lectins induce bacterial overgrowth, that increases bacterial toxins, that spreads these gut cells apart. The lectins can go through, then they attack in this picture. They're attaching to a nerve cell. So maybe that's like diabetic neuropathy or like multiple sclerosis. They're attaching to this nerve cell. Then your immune system mounts the attack against them. Okay, so serious stuff. You got to get your gut healed. But it's easier said than done. So what can you do? Okay, what can you do to heal your gut? So the first thing is bone broth fasting. Okay, so a lot of these ancient healing strategies I really, really like, because like I said before, what we're finding is that, you know, God's put all the healing things that we need right here on the earth, right here under our noses. Food grows on plants, we eat it, our body knows how to use it. That's not magic, that's the way it was designed. Bone broth is, you know, an ancient healing strategy that to a lot of Americans are like, bone broth, what is that? You drink bones? But then I love when I do a talk out in the community, like, and there's always somebody there from Europe, and they say, this is just the way that we eat. They say this about the whole thing, you know, eating real food, avoiding some of these things. They say, this is just the way that we eat, because they still do it the way that everybody's always done it for years. Bone broth, that's how they make all their soups, that's how they make all their stews. But you soak bones. It's got a lot of healing to it. Okay, so there's a lot of nutrients and minerals that are actually leached out of the bones, collagen and connective tissue and different things, that's really good for healing inflammation of the gut. So that's why we do it, is to heal the inflammation of the gut. Is to heal the inflammation in the gut. Try to get my slides back up. I was having a difficulty there. So it actually decreases inflammation. So you want to fast on it. Okay, we'll put our patients on a 3 to 7 day bone broth fast. You know, some people are more ambitious. I just had a patient finish a 28 day fast, a water fast. Okay, so no bone broth, just strictly water. There's a lot of healing in fasting. That's another ancient healing strategy. She did 28 days. Not something that we told her to do necessarily, so don't get scared when I'm putting you on a 28-day fast. Fasting is always something you want to do with a doctor's supervision. But we've had patients do 8-day bone broth fast, feel amazing. You know, I've had patients not be able to get 15 pounds to budge in a few months of diet, do a bone broth fast for a week, and all of a sudden it starts coming off. The weight starts coming off, the energy comes back, skin improves, mental clarity improves. You know, the gut really is your second brain. You've probably heard that, and you know that, you know, 80% of your immune system resides in or right outside your gut. It's just so incredibly important that if it's bad, when you start healing it, you start feeling better really, really quickly. So bone broth fasting. We have an article on our blog that explains exactly how to do this. So what we do personally, you know, we get grass-fed bones from a farmer here in Utah. We soak them in apple cider vinegar. It sounds really hard. I was really intimidated at first. It's stupid easy. You just put it in a crock pot, you turn it on, and you leave it for 2 days. It literally takes maybe 10 minutes the first time I did it. Now, if I wanted to make a batch, it would take me 5 minutes or less. But bone broth fasting, read the article on the blog. Number two is the big one. It's probably the one that most people know about, and it is take a probiotic. But I'm very specific about this because you do not want to go out and just pick up your probiotic that you saw Aaron Andrews advertising or anybody else for that matter. If it's being advertised for, don't buy it. You know, quite frankly, I mean, anything, you know, food, medication, supplements, if they're advertised for, don't buy them. But a couple things, and before we go into what you want to look for, what you don't want, you know, probiotics, they have different strains. Okay. These are different strains of bacteria. And with these different strains, your body has trillions and trillions of bacteria in your gut. It's about 4 pounds of bacteria in your gut. So, I mean, you can't even picture a 4 pound ball of bacteria. It's a lot, okay? Trillions and trillions and trillions of them in your digestive system. And so when you go out and you get a probiotic, maybe it's like an acidophilus, really, really popular one. Acidophilus, and you start taking an acidophilus. Well, acidophilus is a good strain, but you can create an overgrowth. You know, you want to have a variety. So once again, going back to the wall and going back to the city, you know, imagine if you had a city and it was all me. That would suck. You know, it's not necessarily a bad guy. I don't consider myself a bad guy necessarily, but you still don't want all the same good guys. You want variety, right? So you don't want just overgrowth of good bacteria either. You don't want to create a monoculture of good bacteria. You have to have a huge, huge variety, and that's really, really important. So one of the things you want to look for is that it's broad spectrum, see that there, and that it's high CFU or colony forming units. And this is, you know, these top three strategies, really, we could stop here, because for 90% of people, if you do these first three strategies, you're going to be able to heal autoimmune. You're going to be able to get healthy. The next two are more intense. But the probiotic is a must. One of the things you want to look for, a couple of the ones that I'll talk about, this is the best probiotic on the market. Can I block that? It's called Prescript Assist. Jeez. Okay, so Prescript Assist, best probiotic on the market. Anyway, if you can't see that, you know, contact our office if you need it. You can find it online or something. But Prescript Assist, that's the only probiotic I've ever seen mentioned by name, you know, in this book and in many other books, specifically saying take this probiotic. Don't take a good one. Take this one. These are what's called soil-based organisms. They're probiotics and prebiotics. I can't go into the science. You know, we can go into that in October when we do our gut health webinar, the science behind this. But this is the best probiotic that I've ever found, that I've ever seen on the market. This is a close second. Okay, this one's called MBC, which stands for microbiome colonizer. Okay, this one has 10 strains. This one has 29 strains. Okay, so when you're looking for a lot of strains, this has 29. Garden of Life, for example, great brand, 31 strains in a lot of theirs, 33 strains in some of theirs, 29 in like their basic women's, I think, and 85 billion CFUs. So you want to look for the number of strains and the number of CFUs. That's basically the strength. Okay, so this, for example, can't read that probably, but it says 100 billion. And I know the, you know, this company we use a lot, and they're 45 minutes north of me. So I know the biochemist that developed this. I've been up to their lab. And one of the reasons why I like this one is, you know, Dr. Shane is a microbiome expert, but they've actually tested this at 200 billion CFUs consistently, but they put 100 billion on the label just to be safe. But they've tested it over a year, still 200 billion CFUs. So anyway, they're very, very strong. So I'll take a combination of both of these for myself personally. I don't take them every day, but I'll take a combination of both of them occasionally. These are necessary part probiotics. Number three is fermented foods. I'm not gonna pull the slide back up, but it's fermented foods. So we talk about these CFUs. 100 billion sounds like a lot, right? You know, you can go to your Walmart probiotic and, you know, it's nothing. I mean, literally, if you measured, it's probably literally nothing. But even what they claim on the package is nothing compared to 100 billion. When you look at fermented foods, so that's, you know, traditional foods like sauerkraut, like kimchi. But then it's also, you know, you could ferment vegetables, you could ferment anything. We've had patients bring us fermented mayonnaise. We've had patients bring us fermented beets. You can ferment anything, it's awesome. But when Dr. Mercola's lab did a study, and what they looked at is in one bite, one forkful of fermented foods, you were in the trillions of CFUs, of colony-forming units of probiotics. So just massive, massive doses coming from your fermented foods. Now, the same thing, you know, don't eat the same fermented food all day, every day, I wouldn't say, but you want some variety. But adding in fermented foods is huge. When you do a gut healing protocol, you know, some people want to be careful about fermented foods. Some people aren't going to respond well right away. So you got to do this in a program. You got to do this in a protocol. You can't just take this advice and go wing it. For a certain percentage of you, you'll do fine, but it's not what I recommend. Do this with some supervision. Go through a program of a bone broth fast and then re-inoculating, repairing the gut, things like that. Number four is digestive enzymes. And I'm going to pull the, actually, before I do, I'm going to show you this, and then I'll pull the slide back up. This is just an example. Can't even read what that says. It says multi-digestive enzymes. This one has 22 different digestive enzymes. And when you flip it over and look at them, it's things like protease. So you could probably guess what that breaks down. It helps break down protein. What's another one that you might be able to guess? Amylase breaks down starches. Lipase, you probably can't guess that, but that's fats, lipids. It breaks down fats. So these are your digestive enzymes. And I'm going to pull up the slideshow real quick and just show you something here. So digestive enzymes, number four. You go back a slide or two to this, and we look at these green things, food particles. Okay, so when a bigger food particle breaks through your gut lining, creates bigger holes in your gut lining, that's not good. So you want to have good digestion. You want to have good enzymes. You want to have good hydrochloric acid production, because that breaks down your food so that they're not undigested food particles breaking through your gut. Okay, and so this is something we're going to get into really detailed in October. Do a gut healing webinar and have a gut healing protocol. But it's incredibly important. It's something that I personally just got really, really into a few years ago, because I feel like the gut is one of the causes of disease. But now what I've realized is that the gut is a massive component. And people that speak to it as that it's the only cause, they're not looking around enough. They're not looking upstream. They're not looking at toxicity. And unfortunately, I've had some patients that have dealt with that, and they've worked only exclusively on their gut for years and years and years, and they just haven't gotten the wellness results that they kind of wanted and were expecting. So that is number three. These last two we're going to go through pretty quickly. They're more intense. You need to work with a practitioner for both of these next two. I'm going to give you some general, once again, umbrella advice, but you need to work with a practitioner, a nutritionally based chiropractor, a functional medicine doctor, a naturopath. But you know, find somebody that's really teaching the right stuff, quite frankly. You know, there are some autoimmune cases where, you know, they're beyond my scope, and I would tell you that we can help support them without a doubt. But these next two, they get a little more intense. So number four is balance your immune system. So remember I said autoimmune diseases, they're an immune system dysfunction. Chronic inflammation is an immune system dysfunction. You know, you think about it, if I take you right now and I fingernail just scratch you on the hand, what's it going to look like in a couple minutes? It's going to get red. It's going to get puffy. That's inflammation. Inflammation is great. It's an immune system response. It's one of the things that keeps us alive. But when it becomes chronic, it's a dysfunction. Okay, another immune system dysfunction, you know, autoimmunity, it might be hyperactivity of the immune system. But probably, you know, the most common would be cancer. You know, cancer is when your immune system isn't shutting something off and something's growing uncontrollably. But these are immune system dysfunction, so you have to look more specifically at your immune system. One of the things that a lot of practitioners will do is look at, are you what's called TH1 or TH2 dominant? Okay, so in your immune system, you got a lot of different components, but one of the big ones is looking at what's called your T helper cells. And you can either be you have a TH1 side of your immune system and a TH2. And basically, in very layman's terms, TH1 controls things like chronic infections, long-term, you know, food responses, meaning like you eat something today and today's Tuesday, on Thursday, you're going to be dragging. So longer-term allergic reactions, chronic low-grade infections, and underactive TH1 is probably the most common thing. You got to Google this because we're scratching the surface on it, like I said. But TH2 is more like, that's your allergies. That's like you step into a room and somebody's perfume just lights you up and you got a headache and you can't listen and you've got to leave right away. Or you're really sensitive to smells, or you're really sensitive to gluten, or you're really sensitive to this, that, or the other. You just can't have it. That's your TH2 immune system. So most people, I say most, but really, you just have to know. You have to know. TH2 means that your body's attacking more things. So if you're TH2 dominant, your TH2 high response system is going haywire, and your TH1 system is laying dormant. So that's chronic low-grade infections, like candida is a big one, Lyme disease. So you know, I got a patient that he's been tested for candida overgrowth, really, really healthy guy, personal trainer, paleo eater, you know, just healthy guy, wipes out this candida, and then it comes back. Wipes out this candida, and then it comes back. You have to look upstream at the immune function and also maybe even some toxins, like what's causing this imbalance. But his TH1 system is underactive, so he's going to need to boost that. And his TH2 system, now maybe not him, but in a lot of people, it's hyperactive, so you have to lower that. You can be high in both, and there's different foods that are going to affect each of these. So you might take echinacea, for example, for an immune booster, but if you're TH1 dominant, you're just kicking up your TH1 immune system. Is not really helping you fight your colds or your flus or things that you're taking it for. So you really have to know about these things, your immune modulators, your essential oils, your other things. There are some basic ones that I will show you of what you can take to balance your immune system overall. Because that's what we're really looking at, is balancing your immune system overall rather than raising TH1 or TH2. So how can you do that without messing it up? First one is probiotics. Massively, massively important. We just talked about that. 80% of your gut reside, or 80% of your immune system resides in your gut. And once again, you know, think about this. Where do you want your army? If you're the king of the village or whatever, king of the city, where do you want your army? You want them right by the wall. You know, you want them as soon as invaders come in, you want them to be able to attack. You don't want them in the middle. You want them right next to the wall. So probiotics and gut health, big, big thing. Let's see, I'm going to close this out so that I can show you some. But vitamin D is another big, big, big one. So that's one that a lot of people know about today. They take vitamin D. But it's another thing that you just got to get tested. I mean, honestly, I'm a big fan of testing. I'm a big fan of muscle testing and things too, and being cost effective, because, you know, we're a cash office. Insurance doesn't cover this testing, so I like to avoid testing as much as possible. But I've had people that will test high in vitamin D, and I've had people that will test low in vitamin D, and it's about their lifestyles are about the same. And even this summer, you know, I've had people test low in vitamin D, and they're like, I'm outside, I'm at the pool, I'm hiking. And genetically, you could have a defect. You know, my best friend tested his genes and found out that he had a genetic defect that his body just didn't utilize vitamin D in the same way as everybody else. So that's something that you want to know. But here's the vitamin D that we use. You see, it says vitamin D3. It's also, this is a liquid. You got to get vitamin D3. You can't take vitamin D2. That's actually horrible. You got to take vitamin D3. Most vitamin D's are. But the one thing that I will say that you want to do with vitamin D, this has vitamin K2 in it, okay? And vitamin K2 is really, really important, just as important as vitamin D or calcium when it comes to the calcium, vitamin D, parathyroid hormone, bone metabolism. So this is a really good one. Once again, from Systemic Formulas, it's a liquid. I think they make it in a gel cap too, but it's easy to squirt in your mouth. Vitamin D. The next one is your omega-3s, okay? So that's fish oils. That is an easy one. But also, once again, just like your probiotics, one that a lot of people can mess up. You can easily mess it up. This is the one that we do. This is one that I don't necessarily say that you have to take this one. This is a great brand, but there are other brands out there. So your fish oil, once again, best thing is to get it tested. You know, you want to be 3-to-1 to 5-to-1 in omega-6s to omega-3s, which are your fish oils. So how much you need to raise that omega-3 is dependent on where your sixes are at. When I tested myself years ago, I was 30-to-1. Okay, our patients average 20-to-1. Our average, you know, conventionally raised animal product averages 25-to-1. So that's most of us, and that's a massive, massive cause of inflammation and immune problems. So you just need to raise those omega-3s. But the only way to know exactly how much you're raising it is by getting it tested. So once again, this is something I don't do every day. Like today, for example, I had a salmon salad for lunch, so no omega-3s. But on a regular basis, I'm definitely have a good intake of omega-3s because it's hugely, hugely important. And then the last one is chiropractic. And my favorite one, probably the one that most people are saying, well, gosh, I've heard of the rest of them. You know, why chiropractic? Well, chiropractic is not just about musculoskeletal complaints. It's really about your overall nervous system function and regulation. And we see immune system issues improve through chiropractic adjustments. You know, and that's anecdotal. That's what we see in our office. But you can look at the peer-reviewed research on this. And there's some out there that shows that adjustments influence the immune system right away. So you have to get your immune system under control. And remember that if you have a thyroid condition, or excuse me, if you have an autoimmune condition, it's not a thyroid condition, it's not a gut condition, it's not a brain condition, it is an immune system condition. Okay, and then the last action step, the last thing we're going to talk about, fix your cells. Okay, so fix your cells. And what happens is, you know, when we talk about the destruction, you know, that's caused by the fire, the inflammation fire, that is, you know, how much destruction is done on the cellular level. So when we talk about, you know, your house is on fire, maybe you lost your living room, maybe you lost your whole first floor, maybe you lost your whole house. The destruction is determined by how much the fire spread and how quickly they were able to put it out. But you have to fix your cells to get well. That's for every single person. You know, a lot of the people that we've had, you know, do some cellular healing in our office, they don't have any complaints. They don't have any symptoms. They just want to get healthier. And once again, you know, if we went back to that spectrum where there's the green side on one end, the healthy, and then there's the unhealthy on the other end, every single person is between this end and that end. You're just somewhere along the lines. Everybody has a match lit. Okay, there's nobody, you know, once you blow out your match, then you're done. So everybody, you know, my daughter is 2 years old, they have a match lit. They have a slight amount of inflammation, a healthy amount of inflammation, but we don't want that to start getting out of control. So you have to be able to heal your cells to get well. So there's five things. We teach the five R's of cellular healing. This is Dr. Pompa's formula of five R's of cellular healing. Our number one is remove the source. So that's detoxifying your life, like we talked about. Get rid of the toxins, get them out of the cells too. You know, use something like cytodetox to get in and actually bind those toxins and get rid of them. Our number two is regenerating the cell membrane. Okay, so that's the outside of the cell. That's, you know, what lets the good stuff in and the bad stuff out of your cell. We could easily use the wall analogy again, but too many walls. But you have to regenerate that cell membrane. You have to rebuild it. You have to R3 restore your cellular energy. Okay, so with a lot of 21st century diseases, one of the biggest things that everybody is feeling, brain fog and lethargy. And I say that everyone because, man, oh man, when I first did my true cellular detox, I always tell patients this, if you would have asked me when I started it how I felt on the health scale, I would have said, well, I'm a 10. You know, maybe 9.5. I feel really healthy. I'm young, I'm fit, I'm active. But I had no idea how much better I could feel. My brain fog was insane that I didn't even know it was there. But when it was lifted, it's like, oh my gosh, this is how I'm supposed to feel. And we've had a lot of people that are doing true cell detox that said, I'm so motivated to continue doing this because of how amazing I feel. My energy, my sleep, my lethargy, my brain fog, my focus is insane when you restore cellular energy and really get to the cells. Our number four is reducing any cellular inflammation. And our number five is reestablishing methylation. Okay, those are kind of intense to talk about on this webinar. And we're wrapping up right now. But how's that done? You know, how do we get into the cells? A lot of supplements. You know, your food gets in. Big time, but to regenerate the cells, you know, to rebuild the cells, you know, if your house has been burned down, you got to hire a contractor, right? I mean, somebody's got to come in and lay new studs. Somebody's got to maybe come in and lay a new carpet. Somebody's got to go in and put up new drywall. You got to rebuild some of this stuff. But luckily, you know, you don't have to rebuild your whole house if it hasn't been completely damaged. So how do we do this? Here's some supplements. I don't know if you've ever read this at all. But this says, this is a methylation donor. It's called Moore's. Here is one that I take, my kids love this. The membrane regeneration. So regenerating your cell membranes. There's a Vista 1, it's called, and a Vista 2, which are membrane regenerators. These are massively important. But instead of giving you, you know, a handful of supplements, take it home, take all these, take this twice in the morning, take this at night. This isn't about taking supplements. What they've done with true cellular detox is actually packaged this together really nicely. So, you know, this is called a prep phase. And this is a 90-day program to regenerate your cells, restore your cells, get your cells functioning again. It uses these five R's to get your cells functioning again. It also uses those true binders to go in and bind toxins and get rid of them. It also supports your liver, your kidneys, your gut, all your detox pathways. But what it's done is it's packaged it really well. It's taken them and you just take, instead of taking, you know, 25 supplements, you take one packet in the morning, you take one packet in the evening in the prep phase. That's month one. Month two, you move into what's called a body phase and it adds a little more. You take morning, evening, and nighttime, and you take some droppers of cytodetox. Then there's another phase called the brain phase. I won't show that, but what that does is actually gets deeper into the brain tissues to get these toxins that are stored deep in there that are creating inflammation in your brain. Leads to things like autism in kids, but Alzheimer's and dementia. in adults. That's what you got to do. Do the true cellular detox program to get the cells functioning. Okay, but wrapping up here, I want to just share, you know, a couple things here, because that is really our goal of our office, and what we focus on is providing these solutions. And like I said, you know, for you personally, there might be another big piece of the puzzle that you're not going to find without working with a practitioner. So if you're not working with somebody, you can get healthy and you can get well, but it's going to take a lot of time. It's going to take a lot of work, and it's just going to take a lot. And I want to show you an example of one of our patients, because if you're out there and you're listening to this and you are maybe saying, my gosh, this is great info, but I don't know where to start. Okay. If you don't know where to start, give our office a call. There's a button right below your webinar that you can click to send us an email. Give us a call, say, I don't know where to start. Or maybe you're like other people that you're beyond started. Like, I've been doing this forever. I've read all the autoimmune protocols. I've had, you know, different lab work. I've seen this specialist. I've seen an endocrinologist who told me that blah, 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 that it's all in my head, that adrenal fatigue doesn't exist, this, that, and the other. Maybe you're that person. You need to come into our office. Or, you know, if you want to work with somebody locally where you're at, find somebody locally. But we can work with people today digitally through email, you know, give you some of these resources, and at least get you moving in the right direction. But I want to show you one last thing, and this is just an example and a story from one of our patients. And so these are her lab tests at the top here. So it's going to take you a second to look at this. The top one is called C-reactive protein. These are inflammatory markers, measures of inflammation. C-reactive protein, if you are, you know, a 55-year-old male, you definitely want to know your C-reactive protein. Major, major marker to predict heart attacks. Major, major marker. But it is measure of inflammation in general, not just inflammation in your arteries. So what I want to show you here, and then below there is the sedimentation rate, another big inflammatory marker. But what I want to show you is those are the normal ranges below in italics. And if you look at her first lab marker, it was a year ago. It was June of 2015. She's 4. So she's 5 times the standard range. Then 4 months after that, she's moving in the right direction. She's down to 2.7. But then 6 months after that, you see that massive drop. She dropped from 2.7 to 0.5. Her SED rate down at the bottom there, you see 20 is normal. 47 is where she was at. So over 200% the normal rate. Then she came down to 38, still double the normal rate, still massively inflamed after 4 months, right? So still really inflamed, out of the normal range by far. But then 6 months past that, she's in to the normal range in all of her inflammatory markers. And I love her story. It's not one of our videos, actually. You know, if you don't know, we have a pretty extensive video testimonials on YouTube. We just posted one yesterday that was awesome, of a patient who reversed heart failure. So great. But here's hers. It says, I don't care if I never eat gluten, dairy, or sugar again. It's worth it to feel this good. No drugs were part of this process, not even Advil or Tylenol, just food, supplements, and a lot of probiotics. Okay, and that's the reality of it, is this was not easy for her. Her passion is running. Her goal was to get back to running. It took probably, I mean, over 6 months to where she was running a mile. And so that's tough, but like she says, it was worth it. And that's what all of our patients say when they put this time in. And we've really gotten to the point where we now interview our patients more than them interview us, because we just want to know, are you somebody that's going to be able to pull this off? Because it's not that easy, but it is very possible. And we only really want to accept the people that are going to be able to pull this off, that really want to be healthy, that want to be well, that are willing to do what it takes to get their results. So the last thing I'll show you is just, you know, stay tuned on what's coming up. Check out past episodes of our podcast. Go to iTunes or go to www.realhealthwithdrtaylor.com. Inflammation, stress, there's just tons of good episodes on there. There's upcoming podcasts coming out, one on fibromyalgia. Is it really incurable? I'll give you a hint. I interview a patient that has reversed it, one of several of our patients that have reversed it, so it's not incurable. Alzheimer's, dementia, and heavy metal toxicity, that's a really, really important one, really good one. I just got to finish with the Alzheimer's and Dementia Summit, really great information there. And natural migraine solutions. Next month's webinar is going to be on thyroid disorders. The month after that, really important one, going to be on gut health. So stay tuned on the webinars. Sorry my computer quit, but we are done tonight. And so end your hangout. Have a good rest of your night. Thank you guys for joining us. And we hope to talk to you soon. Keep your eye out for our emails and keep your eye out for those upcoming and future podcast episodes and articles. We'll talk to you in September, first Tuesday of every month, first Tuesday of September. We'll talk about thyroid conditions and get into those. Tell a friend, because every single one of you knows somebody who has a thyroid condition. You probably just don't know it. Have a great night. Be blessed.